This is Steve Sanson and Jim Jonas with another episode of Veterans and Politics. Before we get into our rant, we have three guests today. We have Vincent Ochoa, candidate for Clark County District Court Judge, Family Division, Department S. We have John Eccles, candidate for Clark County District Court Judge, Family Division, Department F. And we have Ken Walther, Republican candidate for Nevada State Assembly District 18. Jim, what's going on, buddy?
Hey, not much, Steve. How you doing?
I'm doing real good. This is our first day with VegasAllNetRadio.com. What do you think of the place?
Yeah, I think it's great. I'm very excited to have a new location, and everything's going good.
And we got a hot board operator, Irma. Yeah. Look how sexy she is. My God, we're doing real good. We even have internet service here.
Yeah.
And we're not crunched up like we used to be. I mean, exactly. your elbow was in my face all the time at the other place, but hey.
So what are you saying, Steve? You don't like being close to me?
Is that what I don't mind. You're smelling pretty good today, though, by the way. So do you have any rants for us?
Yeah, actually, today I do have a rant. We just got job figure numbers back, and the economy lost 131,000 jobs last month. Unemployment stays at 9.5%, and President Obama and Vice President Biden are running around talking about how this is Bush's recession. Well, okay, he's been in office 18 months now. When is he going to take ownership for the recovery? We had an $837 trillion stimulus package that he proposed, pushed through Congress, and he promised that we wouldn't go above 8% unemployment. Now we're sitting at 9.5% unemployment for two solid years.
You know, I think that, this might sound harsh, but we need to get rid of everybody in Congress, all 435 of them. We need to replace them because we got this high unemployment. We got this high foreclosures. We rules of engagement in Afghanistan and Iraq is terrible. We're losing troops. I think we should just replace everybody in Congress and start fresh, have new visionaries, and move on. And I think that's how we should do things.
Well, I agree completely. Stop blaming other people. Start looking at yourself. And then, you know, the American people have some explaining to do on this one, too. They need to stay involved, get engaged in these issues, and go out and vote. And that's the only way we're going to vote out these people that are not doing a good job.
Yeah, some of these people have been in Congress, like, way too long. 40 years, 30 years, 20 years. What are they feeding off the taxpayers, Jim?
Yeah, pretty much.
They need to go out and work in private sector, you know?
So, I mean, that's my main rant. President Obama, your administration, and not just Obama and his administration, but members of Congress, like you pointed out, members of the Senate as well. Take ownership. Let's not keep blaming other people. Let's look at ourselves, what we can do. And quite frankly, if they're not going to do the job, then I'm completely with you, Steve. In 2010, let's just throw every Congress member out, every incumbent gone.
I agree 100%. So let's go right to our first guest, Vincent Ochoa, candidate for Clark County District Court Judge, Family Division, Department S. Vincent, how you doing, sir?
I'm doing great. Thank you very much. It's quite an honor to be the first guest in your new location. It's a very good location, central to the whole city. Really appreciate you inviting me on the show.
Not a problem, Vincent. You've been on our show before.
Yes, I was on the show for the primary sometime earlier this year, and I appreciate the time.
And we have endorsed you as well.
The Veterans in Politics have endorsed me. I appreciate that. Everyone was invited to come and speak, and I think you taped it, and I think you have the tape on your computer.
It's on YouTube.
Yeah, and, you know, it was quite an honor to be endorsed by the Veterans in Politics.
Well, thank you, Vincent. Vincent, why don't you tell us, why don't you give us a bio about yourself and tell us exactly what a family court judge does?
Well, the short bio, I've been practicing law for 30 years. That's 30 years of experience, and most of it's related to family court. I've done divorces, custody, child support, adoptions. I also worked as an attorney general doing termination of parental rights and representing the state and citizens of Nevada in abuse and neglect cases. I also have judicial experience as a North Las Vegas municipal court judge, domestic violence commissioner in family court, hearing master in juvenile court. What we do in family court is divorces, custody, child support. And we also do juvenile court, certify juveniles to the adult system. We do abuse and neglect and try to keep parents from abusing their children and try to reunite families where possible.
Vincent, the last time you ran back in 2008, you were in the general against Cynthia Giuliani. Did I pronounce that correctly?
Giuliani.
Giuliani. And any relations to Mayor Giuliani? No?
No, I don't think so.
And now you're in the general election again in 2010 with Rebecca Wallace. Do you think you're going to be able to finally, I hate to put it this way, beat the woman that you run up against?
Well, I think I have a better chance this time. Last time, number one, it was my first campaign ever. I've never run for anything in my career, high school, college. So just to get your name out there was an important step. And this year I have professional help. I have a political consultant, and I know where the doors are, where to knock, where to make the phone call. So I'm better prepared to make this run.
Hey, Vincent, one of the questions that I have is, isn't it difficult to run an election? I mean, if you get – obviously you're going to need money to win your election, correct? So how do you balance who you're going to get who you're going to receive those monies from in order to run your campaign? And if somebody was a contributor to your campaign, is there any way that you could recuse yourself if that individual unfortunately ended up in your courtroom?
Well, it does take some money. Most of the money is in family court, especially, is self-financed. But you contact the people who are interested in family court, and usually those are family lawyers. There's also like foster families who are interested in family court, maybe some of the consultant groups that do COPE classes, some of the psychologists that are hired by family court. But the money that comes in is very a small amount, is very limited. So definitely I'm not in anywhere near selling my vote as a judge for the amount of money. And that's one of the things people look at is your character, and you have to make that decision. And I think I've proven myself over 30 years. I had plenty of opportunity if I was going to take money from someone to do something illegal or improper or to drop a case. So I have a long history of being an ethical attorney.
How do you get your message out to the voters? Because I know when I first turned 18 and I was excited to have that opportunity to vote, I took that vote very seriously. But quite frankly, sir, I had no idea of who these judges were. I really didn't. So how do you get your name out there and get across to the people how important it is to actually vote for you?
Well, I go to a lot of Women's Chamber of Commerce luncheon, the Latin Chamber of Commerce. I go to breakfast, lunch, and dinner with all these groups trying to meet the individuals, talk to them before the meetings, talk to them after the meetings, appear here on radio show, appear on face-to-face with John Ralston, shows like that, and then go to all the political events in town. So when voters gather to hear another politician speak, I try to introduce myself. I'm there. I pass my cards out. So it's a day-to-day event. You're busy, you know, morning, noon, and night trying to meet the voters. But it's still difficult. You put some billboard signs out. You put a web page together so people can contact you if they have questions. It's just trying to get the voters interested in knowing you, and hopefully they can vote for me or vote against me, but at least they get to know me.
You've been a member of the bar since 79. That's a long time, Vincent. Tell us about the Board of Governors. You're party to the Board of Governors, right?
Right.
How does that work?
Well, first you have to have 9 or 10 attorneys nominate you to run, and then the lawyers in Clark County vote for you. And fortunately, the attorneys voted me, and they know me. Obviously, they have respected me, and they voted me to the Board of Governors. I think it's an important position. We set the policies and procedures for admissions for attorneys into the bar in Nevada, and we also set the discipline. We also try to protect the public in many ways, including from individuals who practice law without a license, and even attorneys who commit fraud or steal from their clients. So we try to, you know, have a a bar that the public can respect. And that's our job, is just to make sure we encourage the attorneys to be the best lawyer possible.
Since you're running for family court, are you familiar with the Sailor Soldiers Act?
I am familiar with that and how it applies in family court.
Tell us about it.
Well, if the person is in the military services and he's in service, he has an opportunity to request a delay in the proceedings if there's a divorce proceeding, so he has an opportunity to come back into the country and defend himself in court.
Yeah, there was a couple of family judges that didn't know anything about the Sailor Soldiers Act, and I had to educate them about that, and I think now they're up to speed. But I thought it was sad that they didn't know about the Sailor Soldiers Act. And if one of the parents asks for custody of a child and to leave the state, and the other party is out of country in the military and had no idea what's going on, and the judge just ruled in favor of that person in front of him, I thought that was that ruling was bad.
Yeah, I think it's unfair and it's a lack of due process, and I think you do a great service in trying to educate us. And I think, especially with the Nellis Air Base here, sometimes we have a lot of individuals from Nellis that appear in family court, and they're not in state, they're not in country. And I think it'd be a good thing for some of the legal officers over there at Nellis Air Base to maybe come and speak to the bar and try to educate more of the lawyers in what the rights are for Air Force individuals and all military individuals, you know, when they appear in court.
Well, Vincent, one of the things I'm glad Steve asked that question. One of the things that I wanted to ask you is, as far as custody is concerned, when you go through a divorce procedure, a lot of people believe that the court is biased towards mothers. So how do you come down on that, as far as, do you have any built-in biases? You think that the mother is better equipped to take care of a child than the father? I mean, what's your philosophy on that?
Well, my philosophy is that I believe the best parent for a child is both parents. In my family, I have two sons and two daughters, so I'm not biased either way. And that's the way the law is. The law is each parent has a 50% chance of having joint custody of the children. You have to take every case individually and look at the facts. In the past, there was a bias. I think part of it was because I think at that time the males did not really ask for custody. They did not fight for custody. More and more now there is an equal division. And we live in a society now where more and more both family members are working, mom and dad. And, you know, what occurred during the marriage, you know, maybe one parent was responsible for raising the children. We take that into consideration as just one factor, but after our marriage ends, we have a completely new life and maybe a new procedure, and maybe now both parents should become involved in raising the child.
So do you think a father is just as nurturing as a mother?
I think they have an equal responsibility and obligation, and they have different values and different things they can teach a child. Whether it's a male child or a female child, I think both parents are important. And I think both parents, I mean, the children love both parents equally, whether they're married or divorced.
So how do you feel? Let me paint you a scenario that a man and woman was married, and they're both fighting for custody of their child. And let's say the man found out that his sexuality is not really towards a woman anymore, it's towards another man. And now he's fighting for custody of the child. Now he has a male lover. And he's fighting for custody, and he's in front of you. What would you do?
Well, I would look at the whole history of the family. If the man has accepted his responsibility as a father, and there's no evidence otherwise, I think both parents they start equal, and it would be the responsibility of the mother, if she's trying to prove that something improper is going on, that it's immoral, for her to present those facts to the court. If other than the fact that the person now apparently is a homosexual, it's just one factor, and unless it affects the child in any other way, in any other moral value way, I think both parents are equally have the equal right to have the child and spend equal time with the child as much as possible, unless there's some other factor that the one party can present against the other party.
Well, Vincent, let me ask you a question on that then. So now we had a judge, sorry, I forget his name, put a stay on Proposition 8 in the state of California, where the people voted that they wanted marriage to be defined between one man and one woman. And now a judge comes in and puts a stay on that, and eventually I believe it's going to go to the Supreme Court. Where do you fall on those? I mean, what's your philosophy as far as same-sex marriage?
Well, number one, as far as marriage is in a religious sense, I believe that every religion has a right to define their marriage in a church. For a civic marriage, I think it should be, unless you have an important reason to deny someone the right to marry, I don't think the government should become involved in a relationship between two people. So religious-wise, you know, some churches have their own marriage. I think they have all the right to protect the marriage in a religious fashion. As far as the civic matter, this case is, like you said, it's going to be going up to the Supreme Court. Basically, the case has just started. It's going to go from the district court now. There was evidence presented, and now it's going to go up to the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals. And after the Ninth Circuit Court, the panel hears it there, then the full court of the Ninth Circuit will hear it en blanc, and then after that, it's going to go to the Supreme Court. From what I gather from just reading the press clippings, the judge held that the government did not have the right to vote someone's equal rights away, and that's the ruling he made.
Right. So I mean, so just as a general philosophy, you as a judge, and I know you're not going to you know sit in on these rulings necessarily, but you will have to abide by them eventually. Where do you think the role of the court is? Because basically Proposition 8 was voted in by the people, and now all of a sudden you have a judge that comes in and says, basically, your vote is worthless. So how do you balance that, the will of the people versus the role of the judiciary?
Well, number one, as a judge, I'm going to follow the law and the Constitution as it is in Nevada, as stated by the Constitution of Nevada and by the Supreme Court. Now, if it's unconstitutional law, then I'm not going to follow that law. I'm going to follow the Constitution. Someone could vote and say, you know, blacks do not have a right to marry white individuals. And then I would have to decide whether that's constitutional or not.
That used to be a law.
That used to be a law, right. And people voted that way. And some courts even voted that way. But, you know, was it right or wrong? You know, you have to look at the Constitution to see if that was a right that could be denied to black people or to white people, that they could marry, have interracial marriages. And it took a long time to make those changes. And it was also a law at one time where you could refuse to rent to certain people. And that was the law. But you have to look at the Constitution and look at the Supreme Court cases in Nevada. And my job as a family court judge will not be to make law. My job will be to follow the law, and that's what I've told everyone that in my campaign, that I'm not there to make law. I'm not there to change the law. I'm going to be following the law in Nevada, and if someone wants to make the change in law, they have to do it up in Carson City, or they can have to do it up in the Supreme Court of Nevada.
You know, they say as far as surveys are concerned, when a male runs against a female, especially in judicial races, the female automatically gets 40% of that vote. How do you plan to overcome that, Vincent?
Well, that used to be true. I think the Judge Halverson case has made people wake up and say, we better look at these individuals as individuals, not as a female or male, and see what their actual qualifications are. And the way I'm going to do that is just to be out there campaigning hard so people can see my qualifications, see that I am ready to be a judge. I have the experience, I have the training, and most importantly, I think I have the the temperament and the common sense to be a judge.
You know, in Moapa Valley, I don't know if you've seen the primary results in Moapa Valley, have you?
In my primary?
Yes.
No, I have not.
Well, you have 440 votes out there, more than any of the candidates you ran against in the primary race. Even your opponent right now, you beat her over 2-1, just to let you know that.
Right. Well, there's a lot of reasons for that. Number one, I'm campaigning out there. The other one is I went out and reached out to Citizens for Responsible Government. They're a very conservative Mormon group and believe in family values. And then I have friends who are attorneys out there, and they're Mormon, and they haven't supported me. And more importantly, I think it has to do with my background. I've been married now for over 37 years. I, you know, been married to the same woman. We have 4 children. So they see that I don't just talk family values. I practice my values at home. And they look at the whole man and the whole experience and background, and they make a judgment. And, you know, I reached out to Moapa Valley, Mesquite, Laughlin. I've gone to every place I've been invited to appear and talk to the individuals directly.
And you don't need an interpreter, do you, Vincent?
Well, as far as Spanish speaking, I don't need one. As any other language, English, I can speak English and Spanish, but other languages, I do need an interpreter.
So we could save some tax dollars there then.
Well, I know the city of Las Vegas, I have a contract with the city of Las Vegas to do criminal work, and they save a lot of money because when I go see individuals in jail or talk to individuals in the court, I don't need an interpreter, so they don't have to call one in for me.
Vince, it's a pleasure having you on the show. Could you give the listeners your contact information and just tell them why they should go to the voting booth and vote for you?
Well, I think, number one, they should go to the voting booth and vote, period. I think we're at a war now. We have 2 wars going on. People are dying to protect our freedoms. I think the very least you can do is to inform yourself of the candidates in every race and go vote. And if your children and daughters are dying in 2 wars, I think the responsibility that you have as a citizen is to inform yourself. They can check my webpage at www.vinceochoaforjudge.com. Or they can call me at my office, and I provide them the information. I'm in family court every day if they want to come down and visit me and talk to me directly.
Well, thank you, Vince, for coming on the show. And we encourage all our listeners to go to the voting booth and vote for our endorsed candidate, Vincent Ochoa, for candidate for Clark County Family Division Department S. That's Vincent Ochoa, candidate for Clark County Department S. This is Steve Sanson and Jim Jonas for Veterans in Politics, and we'll be back momentarily with John Eccles, candidate for Clark County Department F.
Mission is to teach, educate, organize, and awaken our veterans and their families to select, support, and vote intelligently for a better world, and to protect ourselves from our own government and a culture of corruption, and to be the political voice for those and other groups that do not have one. Remember, 1 in 6 veterans are vet.
There are too many homeless vets, and more programs are needed at the VA. Every veteran service organization post should adopt a local homeless veteran.
Funding a VA medical center is inadequate, and building a VA hospital in Southern Nevada is moving at a slow pace. The budget has been flatlined for too many years. The VA is too quick to deny claims and too slow to help veterans gather records in support of claims.
Local politicians ignore veterans and their issues. They perceive a lack of organization among their local veterans and that it won't hurt them at election time. Veterans too often vote party, not veterans issues. All veterans should vote in every election.
Local news media give inadequate coverage to local veteran issues and events. You must send your letters to the editor and voice your concerns.
Please contact your members of Congress and Senate and urge them to co-sponsor key legislation in supporting our veterans. Please support the Veterans in Politics. To get more information, go online to www.veteransinpolitics.com.
So Support your local veteran groups.
We're back. This is Steve Sanson and Jim Jonas with Veterans in Politics. We have John Eccles, candidate for Clark County District Court Judge, Family Division, Department F. John, how you doing?
Good afternoon. Fantastic. How are you, Steve? And thank you very much for having me.
Thank you. John, could you give us a bio about yourself?
Sure. I've had the good fortune of living on four continents. I've lived in Argentina, South Africa, Germany, and the U.S. Went to the University of Toledo College of Law, graduated in 2.5 years. Prior to graduating from law school, I was able to take and pass the bar. I've been practicing exclusively in Clark County, Nevada, since I passed the bar, which has been about 11 years now. And about 85 or 90% of what I do is in family court.
John, you're running against the incumbent, Bill Gonzalez. Why?
You know, when I decided to file for family court judge, I tried to evaluate as best I could where I could make the biggest difference. And in looking at Judge Gonzalez's resume for the position that he holds, you know, he hadn't really had any family court experience prior to ascending to the bench after being appointed by Governor Gibbons. He hadn't handled a divorce. He'd never been the attorney of record in any custody cases. And from speaking with attorneys in the family court bar, it seemed like that was the place where I could make the biggest difference for the people of Clark County.
Did you apply for the appointment when he did?
I did not.
And why not?
At that time, I was just at the cusp of the 10 years, which is required for a district court judge. I wouldn't have minded doing it. And in fact, I think I would have qualified for it, probably by a month or so. But, I wanted to make sure that I got some good family court bench experience. I was subsequently appointed by the family court judges to work as a pro tem hearing master in abuse and neglect cases, juvenile delinquency, and, also in domestic violence court. So I was able to spend the last year or so getting more experience on the other side of the bench.
So, John, one of the things that I noticed here that you said you're running because you have the integrity. So the incumbent doesn't have integrity?
I certainly won't speak for my opponent's integrity. He seems like a genuine guy, one of the nicest guys I've ever met. The problem with integrity, of course, is, you know, it's kind of a buzzword, but the way that you can measure integrity, ironically, is not by the measure of what somebody does when people are looking, but what you do when people aren't looking. And that's it's really hard to express other than to say that, you know, you're a person of high integrity. I'm sure that my opponent has high integrity as well.
Okay, so do you have any specific examples of court cases where you feel that he has made a wrong decision and you would have decided differently?
Oh, yes. I was speaking with a family law attorney who presented a case before Judge Gonzalez. The mother in the case had the 10-year-old son in the back of her car. It was a scheduled exchange of custodial time. And the mother intentionally rammed her vehicle into the father's vehicle. She was arrested. I believe at one point she was actually charged with attempted murder. Ultimately, there was an admission by the mother that she had, in fact, done this. The attorney representing the father opined to Judge Gonzalez that this was an act constituting domestic violence, which would preclude her from either having primary or joint physical custody under NRS 125.480. And at least preliminarily, Judge Gonzalez indicated that he did not see it that way. Ultimately, there was a brief continuance. The matter was brought back about 4 or 5 weeks later. The trial was concluded. And in his written findings, Judge Gonzalez indicated that there had, in fact, been an act of domestic violence, which created a presumption against the mother having primary physical custody. But ultimately, he ended up saying that she had overcome the presumption, and this is a written finding, that she had overcome the presumption by not committing another act of domestic violence in the interceding 8 months. I think that's in direct contravention of current Nevada law. So I definitely would have ruled differently on that case.
Well, tell us about your definition of domestic violence, John.
Well, domestic violence, fortunately, the Nevada legislature has seen fit to define it for me in NRS 33.018. Interestingly enough, under that statute, if you were in a living room with somebody with whom you had a relationship and you knocked your TV over, presumably in an effort to frighten the person that you were with, then that's an act of domestic violence under NRS 33.018. I don't think that people in Clark County or even in the United States in general understand just how sensitive the issue of domestic violence is and how, you know, we really have to be very nice to one another. There's no place for domestic violence.
John, do you actually think that that NRS statute is going a little overboard? Let's just say I come home from work. I'm married, which I'm not presently, but I come home from work and I've just had a bad day, and me and my wife get into an argument and I knock the TV over. That constitutes domestic violence. Do you think that's not just a little bit too sensitive?
Well, the good news, I guess, in a family court setting would be that the instance of domestic violence under 33.018 would have to be established by clear and convincing evidence. That's the standard used by the family courts. So you have a fairly low threshold for what may constitute domestic violence, but you also have a very high evidentiary threshold. I think that's a decent balance. And as Vince pointed out in your last segment, my responsibility, as it will be his, when we're elected to our respective departments, is to enforce the laws of the state of Nevada and not to be judicial activists.
Let's say that two parents are before you, and for some reason you ruled for mom, okay, to get custody of the children, and dad has evidence of domestic violence against mom that you never had before you when you made your original ruling. Would you allow dad to bring that evidence before you so you could recant your ruling and give dad custody of the children instead of mom, because now dad has evidence that domestic violence were taking place in the relationship between him and mom?
Well, that's a very interesting question, and that specific issue has come up before the Nevada Supreme Court. There's a case in Nevada, and you know, I apologize because I'm usually very good about spouting chapter and verse off the top of my head. I really am. But the name of the case escapes me. But the bottom line was that the parties had entered into an agreed resolution on custody. And subsequently, there was a change of custody motion, and dad indicated that neither he nor the court had been made fully aware of the depth and breadth of domestic violence that had been leading up to their agreement. And the district court denied him the opportunity to present that information. The Nevada Supreme Court said, no, absolutely, you can go behind the most recent court order if the court had not been previously made aware of the depth and breadth of domestic violence. So yes, in that situation, it wouldn't necessarily be a recantation of my order, but I could certainly change custody based upon that.
So is verbal abuse a part of domestic violence, or is that a part of the Constitution when it says freedom of speech? Which part is it?
I believe, probably the best way to put it is, I think that most psychiatrists and psychologists will tell you that verbal abuse is symptomatic in some instances of domestic violence. It tends to be a control issue. But that being said, the amount of verbal abuse that's required under 33.018 to qualify as domestic violence under a clear and convincing evidence standard is probably going to be a difficult case to make on its own.
Being a judge and you were in a custody battle between mom and dad, when would you reach a conclusion to say, you know what, I need to get these kids their own attorney? When would you say, I need to assign them their own attorney because apparently mom and dad, it's not working. I need to get them their own individual attorney. When would you make a ruling like that?
probably not. I can't conceive of a situation where I would do that. And it may come as a surprise to the people of Clark County that the only person in the courtroom who's actually charged with the responsibility of looking out for the best interest of the minor children is the judge. Attorneys and clients, they're all advocating positions. It's the judge's job to protect the children. And because that's true, I don't necessarily, I can't act as a judge for the children.
Would you assign a counselor or a marriage and family therapist to the children to make sure the children's state of mind and where they want to, as far as if they want to go with mom or dad, where they want to go, where they want to live, if they're at the age that they can make that determination?
Well, we have two options available to us. Although the resources are strained right now, we have court-appointed special advocates that can be appointed in divorce custody cases. They're typically used in abuse and neglect cases, and their resources are stretched fairly thinly. The other thing we can do is we can route them through a court program called Family Mediation Center, have them interviewed to express a preference and to determine whether or not they're old enough to express that preference. There's this balance, but it's one of the factors that the court can consider. And so we can outsource people or individuals and children for that specific purpose. And if the parties agree, we can also send them out for a custodial evaluation.
Well, John, I got a question for you, and we only got 1 minute, so you probably have to answer this after we finish our break. But so Steve and I have asked you and Vincent some very tough questions. And so, I mean, I just want to get to the heart of it seems like you have to balance what the legislature has written and then also be part psychologist. So at the same, so I would like to ask you, you'll have to answer after the break because it's a long question. Why do you want this job? Because it seems like it's a very difficult job. So that's what I really want to get to is why exactly do you want this position?
Could you answer in a couple of words?
I probably couldn't. I'm very passionate about family law. That's the short answer, but it's my real answer would be much more dynamic. I knew I was going to be a family law attorney before I started law school. I knew I was going to be a family law attorney when I got to Las Vegas. I knew that I wanted to help people through these very dynamic situations, custody battles, the emotion, the money involved. It's all more dynamic than you can get from any other case, including criminal cases.
Okay, John, I just want to forewarn you on this, though. Because we're allowing you to think about it through the break, your answer needs to be really good.
Okay.
Well, John, could you let the listeners know how to get a hold of you?
Sure. Probably the best thing to do, really it's so difficult to get any valuable information about judges or judicial candidates. I would suggest going to my website, john4judge.com. If anybody wants to contact me, the Clark County Election Center has contact information where they can reach me.
Thank you, John, for coming on the show.
Thank you very much for having me. Thank you for being, such an ardent supporter of the veterans, and thank you to our military service members for serving us.
That's John Eccles, candidate for Clark County District Court Judge, Family Division, Department F. This is Steve Sanson and Jim Jonas. We'll be back momentarily with Ken Walther, Republican candidate for Nevada State Assembly District 18.
Listeners, get paper and pen ready to write the following phone number. D, we have met a couple times previously. What do you have for our listeners today?
Well, thank you, Steve. As you stated, we have met. I first met you at the Veterans Forum, February 20th. That's when Family Court Judge Bill Gonzalez stated Clark County courts are reporting a 1% error rate in administration of court documents. That's 10,000 errors for every million documents filed.
I remember that startling statistic. I can't imagine there are well over a million documents documents filed with the court?
That's true. Then I met you again in April on your show. On that show, Judge Candidate Vincent Ochoa stated the family law attorneys know documents are not getting to the judges. The result is family court judges are ordering children to their abusers because they do not have the child's abuse evidence.
What?
Let me state that again. Family court judges are ordering children to their abusers because the judges do not have the child abuse evidence.
That is significant.
Now fast forward to today. Clark County's significant number of abused children are with the party that has a history of abuse to that child.
Why is Clark County allowing that?
Well, testimony given by Clark County staff attorney Joseph Tomasino to Nevada Supreme Court Justice Hardesty answers why. Attorney Tomasino stated he has ordered child abuse evidence destroyed prior to child abuse hearings.
That's an alarming statement. Why would anyone order evidence of abuse destroyed prior to a hearing?
Joey Tomasino said because he doesn't have the storage space.
What can veterans do about this?
I'm glad you asked because this directly affects veterans. Clark County taxpayer dollars are going to pay for defense of Joey Tomasino and the Clark County courts. These tax dollars could be put to use benefiting the county's veterans. The veterans can contact me at 787-0002. That's 787-0002. I can instruct them how to go forward. Already, over 300 complaints have been filed. We are getting Clark County's attention, and with the help of veterans, we will make a difference, and the veterans will benefit.
What is that phone number?
787-0002.
Thanks, Dee.
Thank you, Steve.
Hi, my name is Ken Walther, and I'm the conservative veteran small business owner, candidate for Assembly District 18. I ask you to visit my web, kenfornevada.com. That's ken4nevada.com, to see what my issues and plans are. We need smaller government, not bigger, and we all need to pull together. This is Ken Walther, kenfornevada.com. Join me in taking Assembly District 18 back for the people. I approve this message. Thank you.
Paid for by the Friends of Ken Walther.
We're back. This is Steve Sanson and Jim Jonas with Veterans in Politics. Live in studio, we have Ken Walther, Republican candidate for Nevada State Assembly District 18. Ken, how are you doing, sir?
Just fine. Good to be here. A little technical glitch here, but we're okay now. How are you doing?
I'm doing good. Ken, could you give us a bio about yourself?
Well, yeah, I got it, I guess, in my federal service started when I was in the Army. From 64 to 68, I spent 3 years in Southeast Asia doing what was considered to be NSA's ground pounders. We were the ones who were doing tactical intercept and direction finding in the areas over there. When I got out, I found that the CIA was looking for people that needed some special skills, so I went into that, and I spent the next 27 years with the agency, traveling all over the world.
You were 27 years CIA, Central Intelligence Agency?
Yes, sir. 27 years.
I need to ask this question, Ken. Why would somebody as qualified as you, as being part of the CIA for 27 years, have an interest in running for assembly? Aren't you overqualified?
I don't think so. I think that it's just part of a person's duty to fill a slot that might need to be done. I've been interested in politics since I've been out here in Las Vegas, and I feel that we need to get as many conservatives in the legislature as possible. And whether it's an assembly slot or a senator or whatever, we're still voting for the things that will be good for the state.
Well, so on that, Ken, why didn't you run for Senate?
Well, actually, I kind of...
How about U.S. Senate?
Yeah. Well, I'd love to do that, but at the time, we had a problem, I think, with a candidacy, and the lady that was running, who's a great lady, was having a difficult time making her mind up to run or not, and I figured, you know, I'll go ahead and jump in. If we win, fine, and I think we can make a difference.
Could you tell us your feelings on the Second Amendment, and how does that apply to the citizens of Nevada?
Well, I'm a longtime member of the NRA, and I believe that the Second Amendment is something we should uphold. Everyone needs to have the opportunity to keep and bear arms, whether it's for their own defense or for hunting or whatever. And there's too many people in the United States that want to take those rights away from us or lessen our freedoms to enjoy.
You know what? That brings me to a question. And the Costco event, when that Army veteran who was shot and killed by Metro Police, who had his concealed weapons on him and also had a concealed permit, it makes people wonder now what's, you know, if you're walking around with your weapon and you're legally able to walk around with your weapon, are you going to be shot by Metro, or is your right to bear arms in some kind of jeopardy?
Well, I think that was an unfortunate incident, and I've talked to some of my friends that work in Metro, and they had an opinion that the person was acting a little bit strange inside the store, and he was asked to leave the store, and that's the perfect right of any establishment to tell you that you can't have your weapon in their establishment or it's trespassing. So as he left, he was told to obey some of the orders of the Metro, and they misconstrued what he was doing, and unfortunately there was some fire exchange, and he died. But I think I heard a spot with Bob Irwin, who's been around weapons a long time also, and he gave some very good analysis of what was going on there. But I think that if we do have a permit, and there are certain criteria when you are pulled over by the police on what you tell them and what you do as far as putting your hands up, putting your hands in plain view and not making any motions that may be construed as offensive to the police officers.
Well, Ken, one of the specific questions I have for you is, obviously, with spending 27 years in the CIA and working for the government, you have had specific experience with socialized medicine. Because that is essentially what government medicine is. It's socialized. Can you tell the listeners a little bit about how, so they can understand why conservatives like yourself have an issue with Obamacare and why socialized medicine isn't necessarily the way we need to go?
Well, I could talk all day on that. Not only was my military experience with the hospitals fine, but it is not something that you experience in the regular private thing, insurance and medical world. My wife also is Swedish, and she grew up in Sweden. I spent several years in Europe, and I saw what social medicine is. As a perfect example, her dad paid 75% income tax in Sweden. When he became old and had to have a hip replacement, they kept putting him off. He was beyond his productivity. So he had to use his own money then to pay for his hip replacement, that after he'd paid in all this money through his career. And social medicine is just something that we, it's not something that we would want to adapt here. What we need to do is I don't understand why we don't have more insurance across state lines. That doesn't make any sense. And we have to get rid of some of the frivolous lawsuits on doctors. That's going to make a big difference.
So are you for, because presently right now the state of Nevada has a cap, I believe, $350,000. Are you a proponent of that cap?
I don't think there should be a fixed cap. I think that there should be more of a logic used. I don't think if you spill coffee on yourself, you should hit the jackpot. I think that everything should be taken into a more common sense approach as to what your penalties should be on whatever the accident was.
So let me switch gears here just for a second. We got about 4 minutes.
Sure.
You know, if elected, you're going to go to Carson City and you're going to face a $3.1 billion, some say 3.5, whatever, budget shortfall. What are your plans to help fix that? Because obviously right now Nevada is ranked, we got the highest unemployment, highest foreclosure rate, the school, we rank 49th, 50th. What is your plan to be able to fix those issues and be able to solve the budget crisis?
Well, some of our biggest wastes in the government are exorbitant public service employees salaries and retirements. That has to be adapted. We have a lot of things that can be cut down on our expenditures, and I don't think that raising taxes on small businesses of any sort should be allowed.
Do you think that some of the issues with the budget shortfall deals with the influx of illegal immigrants here in the state of Nevada, especially in Las Vegas with UMC in particular?
Well, that is a fact. I think that's been proven in a lot of ways that a lot of the expenditures are on people who are not citizens in this country. And I know quite a bit about illegals and immigration, and I've sponsored people to be here legally. I brought in Russian scientists with visas and so on. And my wife went through all of her immigration roles so she could become a U.S. citizen.
And what country is she from?
She's from Sweden.
Okay.
Is there any specific – we only got 2 minutes left.
No.
Is there some type of specific legislation that you would propose to help curb the cost of illegal immigration?
Well, there's already E-Verify is always being used and successfully. And I believe that everyone should have a chance to live in America. Just get in line. I've worked in embassies all around the world. We're starting at dawn. There'd be lines of people trying to get visas at the consulate. That is, says a lot for the people who want to come over here.
John, Ken, we appreciate you coming on the show. Before you go, could you give us your contact information and give us your boundary lines for Assembly District 18?
Sure. 18 is in the southeast. It starts at Eastern and Robindale. It starts cutting over all the way down Sand Hill, ends up on Vegas Valley Drive, goes on both sides of Boulder Highway and back up to the city limits. And www.ken4nevada.com, that's ken4nevada.com, is a way that you can contact me. And love to hear from the people. I'd love to get the people in our district sensitized to what's going on. I'll be glad to talk to them.
Well, Ken, thank you for coming on the show. That's Ken Walther, Republican candidate for Nevada State Assembly District 18. We encourage all our listeners that live in District 18 to vote for Ken Walther because we have endorsed him. That's Ken Walther for Republican candidate, Nevada State Assembly District 18. This is Steve Sanson and Jim Jonas with Veterans in Politics. Until next week.
Thank you.